Good morning, everyone. No video today, you're just stuck with me up front. I have some announcements today, and you can follow along with your bulletin if you would like. First of all, I'd like to point out, just on the little upcoming list, you'll see an NDI meeting. That's Nazarene Discipleship International. So anyone that would like to come to that meeting, if you're a Sunday school teacher, or you're just interested, or some kind of ministry leader, we'll be having a meeting September 10th, 5:30 p.m., and that will be actually down the road at the Equity Northwest office at 5:30 p.m. And then, opening up the page, looking inside, this week is movie night. We're in a new month. Today's the first. So we're our first Wednesday movie night, potluck and movie. So bring a dinner dish to share, and then we'll be watching Jimmy, which is about a 14-year-old boy and his unique perspective on the world, and just kind of the path that leads him and his family down. And they say, they promise, once you see the world from his perspective, you'll just, it'll change the way you see the world. So that's our cliffhanger, and you'll have to come on Wednesday night to see what exactly that means. So 6 o'clock on Wednesday is our potluck and movie. And then, since it's the first week of the month, it's also country gospel singing this Friday at 6:30 p.m. So come on out to enjoy some country gospel music, and you can stop by the big sale table in the foyer to get some baked goods as well. Then coming up partway through the month, the third Sunday of each September has been deemed National Back to Church Sunday. And it kind of goes right along with getting back into school, just getting back into our routines after summer break. So this is a time where if you've noticed someone that maybe hasn't been at church in a while, or maybe they've never been, and this could be their first time to come try it out, we invite you to come, especially on September 15th, and just see how full we can get this sanctuary. And if they want to come early at 9:30, they can come for Sunday school too. And then also on September 15th, we're starting grace groups back up. So right along the same lines here, we're starting groups up. And this is the perfect time. If you would like to start a new group, then you can talk to Pastor John about starting a group, and we'll get people signed up for that. Or maybe you don't want to lead a group, but you'd like to join one. You can do that as well. So we'll get details out about each of the groups, when and where they're meeting. And September 15th will be our first official day back after our summer break. And then at the end of the month, we'll be collecting our September alabaster offering. So this is something we kind of do year round. We'll each collect at home in our little alabaster boxes. And then a couple times a year, we collect the offering and send it in to the World Evangelism Fund. And they use these funds to either buy property or construct buildings to do ministry in. But it's not always traditional church. Some of them is. Some of them goes to building churches, but others go towards building Nazarene hospitals or schools or colleges and other buildings, parsonages, things like that that are used for ministry in other ways. So they're treating their patients, teaching their students, and witnessing to them about Jesus as well. So these are what our alabaster offering goes toward. We'll be collecting the next several weeks, and if you don't have a box yet, you can get one out in the foyer. And then September 22nd, we'll have the big boxes up front for everyone to drop them in. And then my last announcement, you've noticed there's been some changes in the parking lot and some paving going on. We're really excited for these new roads to open up, and it will be happening soon, as soon as the striping is done. So we'll keep you guys posted and be checking your e-minders as well for updates. And hopefully we'll get our new entryway open soon. And speaking of e-minders, if you'd like to sign up, you can just contact me or Anita, and we'll get your email list added to our weekly email newsletter. So that's all the announcements I have today. If you'll go ahead and bow your heads with me, we'll have a word of prayer. Lord, I just thank you for all the beautiful weather we've been having recently and everything fun that comes along with the summer season. I praise you for the time that we've had just to enjoy, and I ask that you be with us in this upcoming season whether it's back to school, back to church, back to work. Just be with each person in their daily lives. And be with us here today as we're all gathered in your house, Lord, in your presence. I ask that you put your touch on each one of us, here or not here. Lord, several people are out today just with different things they're battling, and I ask that you be with them. Put your healing hand on those that need it, especially with Pastor Grady, Lord, today. I ask that you put your hand on him as he comes out of his surgery this past week, and just heal him, Lord. Be with Pastor John as he speaks today, and just bless him and his message. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
We will receive our tithes and offerings. This is a pretty good crowd for Labor Day, I'll say. Yeah. Thank you all for coming. I'm glad to preach today and want to lift up Pastor Grady in just that the Lord heals him. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you, Lord, for just your blessings. I thank you for the sunshine today. I thank you for this congregation, this body of the faithful. Lord, we are an organic unit, and I say that because I feed off of these people just as much, maybe even more, than if they feed off of me. So Lord, help us encourage one another today while the day is still called today. And we want to lift up our pastor, the one who gives us the word. Lord, give him strength, but also patience, Lord, in this time. Patience through the pain and strength, even more strength than what he had before. Lord, bless this offering that we have to give to you. Use it for your purposes to advance your kingdom and your gospel. We love you, Lord. In your name, amen.
Thank you, Jim. Name of that song was, anybody know? That's right. Drinking at the Springs of Living Water. That's a good song. Let's all stand as we sing Victory in Jesus.
Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groanings, of his precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory! Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing. And I heard about the lump again, and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. And I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. And I heard about those streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Amen. You may be seated. Great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadow of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of angels stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one. has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave.
Let's sing that part one more time.
On me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ.
Let's sing that one more time. Hallelujah, all together.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah.
Death has lost its grip on me.
You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living sin. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon, this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this I plead, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Last verse. And this is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Kevin. Thank you, worship team. I don't have slides for you today, so I'll have to do it the old-fashioned way. Just take notes. Use a pen. You know, when I was in high school, they were finding that kids don't have this callus on their finger anymore. Because when you hold a pencil, the wood scrapes your top knuckle right there. And I don't know, maybe have a goal set for your kids to get that callus. So, testing the spirits. If you have your Bibles, please turn to 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. And I'm going to open up the altars at the end of the service today. But if you want to come forward during the service at any time, please feel free to do so. These altars are open. And if you want someone to pray with you at the altar, just raise your hand while you're there. But let's allow those who want to pray by themselves their private time with the Lord. This is 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. I still hear some pages ruffling, so when you're there, say amen. All right, three amens. We're going. Everyone else got to catch up. 1 John 4, 1 through 6. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits, whether they are of God. Because many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. They are of the world, therefore they speak as of the world, and the world hears them. We are of God. He who knows God hears us. He who is not of God does not hear us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. If there's one thing we would do well to remind ourselves as a modern church, it's that a spirit of error, false teaching, and heresy, those have very serious ramifications for the believer. Before the Apostle Peter went to be with the Lord, he said, "There will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them, and bring on themselves swift destruction." The destructive heresy brings on swift destruction. Heresy is no small thing. When we think of heresy, we usually think of just having a difference of opinion. And I get why. It's because people who are self-appointed heresy hunters often make heresy out of very trivial things. But real heresy isn't just a mere difference of opinion. It's a spirit of error that is genuinely destructive to the faith. John goes so far to call a spirit of error the spirit of the Antichrist. A spirit of error is not simply something that falls short of the truth or something that we can have a theological discussion about and come away with different perspectives. A spirit of error is a power that is at work against a spirit of truth. It is a false teaching so harmful to the integrity of your faith that believing it ultimately amounts to denying the Lord who bought you. This is the context of 1 John. John is writing to a church scattered throughout the Roman Empire that has been ravaged by 3 decades of falsehood, when Peter had foretold that false teachers would bring in destructive heresies. That was about 30 years before John writes this letter. So the church that John is talking to, they've probably seen numerous teachers who have loved them and trained them up in Christ bring in destructive teaching, the kind that Peter had foretold. But John knows the source of these destructive heresies and errors. He doesn't see the root of them in individual people, per se, but in spirits. Notice in verse 1 that John doesn't say, "Do not believe everyone, beloved." He says, "Do not believe every spirit." That's a very different thing. A spirit is something that goes deeper than a person conveying its message. We usually think of spirits as personal things like angels or demons or the human spirit. But a spirit might not always be a personal force. Sometimes it's a power or a spiritual influence. Paul says that the Jews who denied the gospel had been given a spirit of stupor, eyes that they should not see and ears that they should not hear. They didn't want it. They didn't want the gospel. And therefore, they were given that spirit of stupor. Every cultural and historical movement has a spirit behind it. And that spirit is held together by a message. And this is why John talks about spirits and prophets being interconnected. He says, "Don't believe every spirit because many false prophets have gone out into the world." The prophet's message is inspired by the spirit behind it. And this is why Jesus taught us that we will recognize false prophets not by their words, but by their spiritual fruit. You can tell what kind of spirit they have by what fruit they produce. Do they produce the fruit of the Spirit, or do they produce something more like the works of the flesh? Are they producing love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control? Or are they producing rotten things like anger, lust, lewdness, gluttony, self-pleasure, or bitterness? Notice also in this passage that the Holy Spirit involves and directs other little spirits in the ministry of the gospel. There's the spirit with a capital S, and then there's a spirit with a lowercase s. And that is in the Greek. There's no mistaking the article. It says, "By this we know the Spirit of God," capital S, "every spirit," little s, "that confesses Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God." Christian history shows that the heresies John had in mind when he was talking to the church at this time, they were primitive forms of what we know today as Gnosticism. If you've been following this sermon series, I think for about a year and a half now, you might have heard me talk about Gnosticism a couple times. Gnosticism was pretty wild. It's kind of difficult to pin down everything that the Gnostics believed because it wasn't a religion. It was more like a Persian and Greek occult movement that fed off of other belief systems. There were Jewish forms of Gnosticism before Jesus, and there were lots of Greek versions, and there were Persian forms before there were even Christian ones. In general, what we can gather, though, is Gnosticism taught that your body is a prison, and that your spirit can be free from that prison through a kind of secret knowledge that comes from looking inward. Christians who became part of this movement, this Gnostic movement, they made their own version of Gnosticism. Some Christian Gnostics, like the Docetists, they thought of Jesus more in terms of a spiritual archetype that liberates whatever soul it makes contact with from its fleshly prison. They thought of him like that instead of the Word of God who became a real human being and dwelt among us. And they thought of Jesus and Christ as being two different entities because they believed that he became God at his baptism and that he wasn't God to begin with. And they saw his death on the cross as liberation from the human spirit, of the human spirit from the prison of the human flesh. And the resurrection, of course, is symbolic. This is why Paul rebukes them in 1 Corinthians for believing that the resurrection isn't real. That is far different from what Christians actually believe. One thing I found about Gnosticism is that it never really goes away. There's always some form of it going on. In our day, it's actually very trendy. Mormonism is very Gnostic. New Age spirituality also sees Christ in a very Gnostic way, especially when you combine all the drugs with UFOs and everything in between, you get a whole mess. I might do a lesson on this for the adult class in the future, but Jungian psychoanalysis is also rooted in Gnosticism. If you don't know who that is, Carl Jung, who is second to Sigmund Freud in his contributions to modern psychology, was a modern Gnostic. He barely left any room for Christ in the realm of psychology. And the view of Christ that he did hold was a spiritual archetype with sort of a dark counterpart that, in Jung's words, made Christ unlovable to him. And I bring up Jung because if you've heard of any test that talks about people being introverts or extroverts, that's Carl Jung. I only say that because his influence shouldn't be understated. And I'm not saying that to say that psychologists are Gnostics, because it's not a religion. You don't have to agree with it. But I am saying that we should look at that because there's some presuppositions behind all that don't quite line up with the real healer. So let's just be aware of that. But all forms of Gnosticism, whether they're very ancient ones or very modern ones, they're all checked by this one test. They do not really confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. When it comes to Gnosticism, and whatever form it takes, it really boils down to the idea that Jesus isn't really human. He's not really flesh and blood. Gnosticism and Gnostics are more comfortable with Jesus being anything but truly human at any point in his life. But the Christian view is, and always has been, the belief that Jesus is fully God and fully human at every point in his life, even now. He was God when he was first conceived, and he is still human even after his resurrection. He is not a disembodied spirit. Behold my hands and my feet, that it is myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have. He said that to his disciples in the upper room. Nor is there any broken bone in him. And that's good news for us today, because if the Godhead and the humanity are perfectly joined together in Christ, and Christ has perfected our human nature forever through his sufferings, through his death and resurrection, then there is no more rift between us and God, as long as we are in Christ. We truly have all the blessings of Christ when we believe in him and are sealed with his Holy Spirit. We are his body. We are his flesh and bones. And that is the biggest compliment, the biggest honor that God could ever bestow on us. The spirit of truth and the spirit of error, they wage war over that doctrine, that Jesus has really come in the flesh. And this is the way you can test whether or not a spirit is from God, says the Apostle John. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. That's the test. Now, we understand that pretty well. We're not Gnostics. We know that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. I'd be preaching to the choir if I just ended my message there. But there's always a deeper truth to that confession. It's not enough to simply confess with our mouths that Jesus has come in the flesh. We must confess that with our hearts and with our very being. What that means is every spirit that we test must line up with that confession. Jesus not only has to come in the flesh and dwell among us, he has to come into us and dwell in us. Our life has to be a testimony, not just that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh, in the human nature, but in my flesh, in my human nature. If you don't get anything else out of this sermon, I hope you get this. The spirit of error is about distancing us from Christ. The spirit of truth is about bridging that distance. If you want to write that down, I'll repeat it. The spirit of error is about distancing us from Christ. The spirit of truth is about bridging that distance. And for the next few weeks, I want to walk us through three spirits of error that prevent us from allowing Jesus Christ to come into us and dwell in our flesh. The first spirit is a spirit that says, you must keep the law in order to be saved. And the second spirit is a spirit that says, you don't have to keep God's commandments in order to be saved. And the third spirit says, did God really say that? I'm going to devote a sermon to each of these erroneous spirits, but the main idea will be the same, that the spirit of error is about distancing us from Christ and from God in Christ. And the spirit of truth is about bridging that distance. So today, we will only cover the first spirit of error, the spirit of the world and the spirit of the Antichrist, that classic spirit, the spirit of legalism. The spirit of legalism says, you must keep the law in order to be saved. After the Gentiles received the Holy Spirit, a sect of the Pharisees, who were also Christians, made their way from Judea to Antioch and told the Gentile Christians, unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. And they told everyone in the Jerusalem council, it is necessary to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. But Paul, who was also a Pharisee Christian, he had no small dissension and dispute with them, because he knew that that spirit was antithetical to the gospel. In John's words, it was an antichrist spirit, a spirit that is opposed to Christ. Now, some of us may have actually fallen into that same trap. After all, shouldn't you do what's in the Bible? Shouldn't you live accordingly to the whole word of God and not just some of it? But Peter told them, that is a burden that neither us nor any of our fathers were willing to bear. This is Acts 15, 7 through 11. And when there had been much dispute, Peter rose up and said to them, men and brethren, you know that a good while ago God chose among us that by my mouth the Gentiles should hear the word of the gospel and believe. So God, who knows the heart, acknowledged them by giving them the Holy Spirit, just as he did to us. and he made no distinction between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Now, therefore, why do you test God by putting a yoke on the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear? But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, that we shall be saved in the same manner as they. Holiness is about the purity of the heart, not the performance of every little law. It doesn't matter your background or how long you've been a Christian or what spiritual disciplines you do or don't do. We shall all be saved in the same manner through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. John Chrysostom put it this way. He said, "Even if we stand at the summit of virtue, it is by mercy that we shall be saved." The reason that a spirit of legalism is a spirit of the Antichrist, a spirit of error, is because legalism is antithetical to grace. Legalism does not trust grace. Grace is too good to be true for the legalist. The legalist has a spirit that is married to an ideology instead of the gospel. When they hear that someone's heart has been purified by faith, someone who doesn't look like them, they think to themselves, I'll know it when I see it. Paul could see right through the Christian Pharisees because he himself used to have a highly legalistic spirit. And he knew the Pharisee Christians were not concerned with the salvation of the Gentiles. They couldn't stand to think that God would dwell bodily in someone who wasn't Jewish. And even though they made their concerns about salvation, Paul knew that when they said it is necessary that they keep the law of Moses, what they really meant was they have to be like us in order to really be like Jesus. Paul hits it right on the nose in Galatians 4:17 when he says, "They zealously court you." That means they want your favor, but for no good. Yes, they want to exclude you so that you may be zealous for them. Not for Christ, but for them. In other words, people who have this spirit of error will tell you or give you the impression that you're not really a Christian because you don't do X. Or you don't really have the authority to do such and such because you don't belong to Y or to us. The Apostle John himself did this to someone who was casting out demons in Jesus' name. In Mark 9, 38-41, John came up to Jesus and said, "Teacher, we saw someone who does not follow us casting out demons in your name, and we forbade him because he does not follow us." Now, maybe John had good intentions there. Maybe he thought, well, this guy is probably going to start spreading different ideas about Jesus since he wasn't directly being discipled by Jesus like the apostles. But Jesus said, "Do not forbid him. For no one who works a miracle in my name can soon afterwards speak evil of me. For he who is not against us is on our side." The Spirit of God is bigger than any walls of a church. He is bigger than any tradition. He is bigger than any form of Christian training. He is bigger than any ideology. The Spirit of God is so vast that even if someone is so much as not against a disciple of Christ, he is on their side. And they are on his side. Jesus does not want people to follow us. He wants them to follow him. Jesus forbids sectarianism. He forbids his followers to be against each other, especially when they're doing his work. And he certainly forbids us from guilting others into becoming dependent upon us to become his disciples. They want to exclude you so that you will be zealous for them. You can never please a spirit of legalism because you are always trying to appease a power that lives on making you feel inferior and insecure. A Christian cannot have the spirit of legalism, whether for themselves or for others. And Jesus taught both James and John this lesson when they wanted to call down fire upon the Samaritans for refusing to accept Jesus. This is Luke 9:54. And when his disciples, James and John, saw this, that they had rejected him, they said, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them just as Elijah did?" There they go, looking to the Bible to feed their spirit of legalism. But he turned and rebuked them and said, "You do not know what manner of spirit you are of. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them." And they went to another village. The spirit of destruction and law and calling fire down upon our enemies is not the spirit of Christ. That's the spirit of the Antichrist. The Antichrist is the one who will come to conquer and destroy men's lives, not to save them. See how we can confess with our mouths that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh and yet have the wrong spirit. We know the spirit of Jesus if we know what he came to do. The Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. That's the spirit of Jesus. Not the spirit that destroys, but the spirit that saves. Instead of a spirit that says, "You must keep the law to be saved, or we will call down fire from heaven upon you," the spirit that comes from God says, "I did not come to destroy you, but I came to save you." It means that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh to save us, not to destroy us. And that's important because Jesus has come to save us from heresy, not destroy us for it. He has come to save us from a false spirit, from false perspectives and false teachings about him. Not because he's nitty-gritty or picky about what you think about him, but because he really wants you to know him. He came to save us from the heresy that if we aren't trying hard enough, he's going to send us to hell. That is not the spirit of Jesus. We Nazarenes have not really been immune from this spirit of error. As a denomination, we were known pretty well, especially in the 70s, for being rule followers and legalists. I grew up in churches where I wasn't allowed to wear jeans to church. Me, the pastor's kid. Or someone would think my mom was a bad pastor's wife. And that's what we would hear, not about the revival or the spirit, but what my mom let her kids wear to church. When I was 3 years old, my dad took us to see Toy Story 2 in the theater, but he took us to a movie theater 4 miles out of town because there was a superstition going around in the church that if a pastor went into a movie theater and Jesus came back during that time, that pastor wouldn't be raptured. I am not kidding. I'm not making this up. On a more serious note, I've also attended churches where board members would turn up their noses to people who were divorced. And I've attended churches where they split the youth group because the board members didn't want their kids hanging out with kids who smoked, even though those kids were saved. And smoking was the least of what God had saved them from. And then those kids who smoked, when they did give their lives to Christ, the youth pastor baptized them in the creek because the prominent members of the church were appalled to think that those kids deserved to be baptized in front of the congregation. That is the exact opposite of holiness. William Greathouse tells us that as holiness folk who believe in Christian perfection and entire sanctification, we need to make a distinction between Christian perfection and perfectionism. Christian perfection is not perfectionism. Christian perfection is about being complete, not flawless. William Greathouse says, "Holiness is not the second effort, it is the second rest." A believer who has yielded utterly to God and has received the infilling of the Holy Spirit is not uptight, trying to dot every I and cross every T in order to please God. When Jesus tells us that we shall be perfect as our Heavenly Father is perfect, he is talking about having pure love to God and humanity, not being perfect in our performance. Perfectionism leads to cheap grace, but Christian perfection is grace overflowing. That's because holiness is having purity of intention, not perfection of execution. Someone whose heart has been purified by faith is very conscious of their constant need for grace. Paul says in Philippians 3, 12 through 15, "Not that I have already grasped it or have already become perfect, but I press on if I may take hold of that for which I even was taken hold of by Christ Jesus." Brothers and sisters, I do not regard myself as taking hold of it yet, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead. I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And therefore, all who are perfect, let us have this attitude. The Christian who is pure in heart should think of themselves as forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead. I know I'm not perfect, but I will be saved just like everyone else through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Christian perfection is sort of like wisdom. You are wise when you know how unwise you are and how much you need wisdom. You are perfect in the godly sense, and you are pure in heart when you realize how imperfect you are. And just like Peter said to the Council of Jerusalem, it doesn't matter where we grew up or how much training we had or our background. We'll be saved all the same way through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. I want to open up these altars as we take communion, if the ushers will come forward today. As you prepare your hearts today, I want you to know this. You are not to be insecure about your salvation. Rebuke those spirits which cripple you and tell you that you are not good enough. They zealously court you, not for your own good. But Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. He has bridged that divide. He has not come to destroy you, but to save you. Let's prepare our hearts. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for your spirit. Not a spirit of error, but a spirit of truth. One that does not destroy or call down fire upon us, but one that seeks to save. Lord, please have your hand over us while we prepare our hearts for communion. In your precious name, amen.
The service is nearing an end. The choir is singing, just as I am. And now as the old song is played, people at the altar are kneeling down to pray. Some are finding mercy, forgiveness of their sins. Some are fighting battles, and they're struggling to win. The time has come to give them to the Lord. That's what this altar is for. That's what this altar is for. You don't have to carry those burdens anymore. There's a light in the darkness. There's a love that's true, and Jesus is waiting. He is waiting here for you. Come quickly now, before they close the door. That's what this altar is for. A father is praying with his son. A mother kneels beside them, thanking God they've come. An old man is standing there in tears, giving up a part of him that he's held back for years. Hearts are being broken, lives are being changed, and those who call upon him will never be the same. The time has come to give in to the Lord. That's what this altar is for. That's what this altar is for. You don't have to carry those burdens anymore. There's a light in the darkness. There's a love that's true. And Jesus is waiting. He's waiting here for you. Go quickly now, before they close the door. Jesus. That's what this altar is for. That's what this altar is for. You don't have to carry those burdens anymore. There's a light in the darkness, and there's a love that's true. And Jesus is waiting. He's waiting here for you. Go quickly now, before they close the door. Your burdens to the Lord. That's what this altar is for. He
wants to heal you. A leper once came to Jesus and he bowed before him and he said, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." And the Lord told him, "I am willing. Be cleansed." On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, he blessed it, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take all of you and eat of it. This is my body, which is broken for you." And in the same manner, after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant in my blood. The cup of the new covenant in my blood. Take and drink and do this in remembrance of me." Heavenly Father, we thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to give us his body and his blood, and through faith in him, to make us one with him. Lord, as these elements sink down into our bodies, let us know that we are incorporated and engrafted into Christ's body, his flesh and blood. Let us be able to say in our spirits, not with a spirit of error, but a spirit of truth, that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. Amen. You are dismissed.